Allow me to welcome you all to a very unusual professional luncheon, since it's a luncheon which is going to extend to 5 o'clock today. And you're all welcome to stay, although the food is gone. But there will be food for thought. And this session is the first third of a three-part project called the Ideas Industry, the first third of which is a professional luncheon given by Professor Kent Calder, who, as your as the notice explains, and as also is here in the bio sheet, is a very distinguished commentator and researcher and student of Japan. He's the author of more than a dozen books on Japan. If you are regular readers of the Nikkei, you will recognize his face as well, and he also appears on television quite regularly to comment on the most exciting parts of Japanese politics, like recent elections and other matters. He has written a book on the penumbra of power, that is, how Washington is no longer just the capital of a single nation state, but is a scene of frantic activity. And this activity involves these days Asian nations in a very significant way. Washington is a global city in the way that, for example, London continued to be a global city for a long time, even to the present day, in spite of the decline of empire. Brussels is very similar. But I will let Kent talk about that, and he will also mention, of course, the ideas industry, of which Professor Don Abelson of the University of Western Ontario, who is here with us, is very much a part, and he is going to talk at 2:15, 2 o'clock actually, in the same room about the role of think tanks, a comparative analysis of how think tanks generate ideas that become policy. And then, if you still able to stay, you can hear me talk about the good side of the Japanese media, news media, which is far too often lambasted and connected with all sorts of evils. So, but let me before that introduce you to our commentator today, who is Professor Yoshihide Soeya of KEIO University, who comes as an added bonus. And Professor Soeya is a distinguished analyst of U.S.-Japan relations, also of Korea as well. And I had the pleasure of traveling with him through the United States for a week. And I know him to be not only articulate, but self-effacing. And this time I would like him to be less self-effacing and intensely articulate, which I know he will be. He is the author also of several works. And we look forward to his comments very much. So with that, I will. I should also tell you, I'm required to say that the exit is over there. And in case of fire, please follow the advice of our staff. And also kindly turn your cell phones off or to silent mode. Thank you very much.
Do you want to talk with this or not? Is this, I don't know if this works.
Well, it's good to see many, many old friends here. I appreciate Andrew's introduction. I know many of you know his work. He's doing some, in the context of our Ideas Industries project, some extremely interesting work on the Japanese media. I think probably the best thing that I've seen in English on that. I'd like to talk today about, of course, the core of what I want to talk about is the transformation of Washington. I think we have a paradigm. We're looking through the back view mirror in many ways in thinking about Washington. Certainly, the heart continues to be the U.S. government and its various dimensions, Capitol Hill, the White House, the different parts of the executive branch, and so on. But that paradigm in many ways is out of date. There's a penumbra of power around the formal side of the U.S. government which has evolved. A lot of this beginning, particularly during the Reagan years, and then it has accelerated us in the last decade, which makes the policy community in a different formulation, the idea industry, on which our larger project focuses, consisting of think tanks, mass media, universities, a whole series of transnational relationships that really have created a dynamic that is replacing and transcending K Street, the traditional heart of interest groups and policy formation outside the government in Washington. So I want to talk about that. That's the heart of what I want to say. But that's in a larger context, which is the change in the global system itself. What I call global political cities are becoming more and more important, even as national governments have less ability to decisively act in international affairs. Cities as actors are coming to be important. We see some of this in the role of people like Michael Bloomberg in the C40 in New York City and so on. But at a different level also, the way that these penumbras, the think tanks, the universities, the mass media, in their interrelationship with each other, come more and more to shape the face of global policymaking. So the first half of what I want to say talks about that transition in international affairs with a focus on Washington. The second half, that in a way is a bit more pointed, it compares the approaches of different Asian nations. In my book, Asia and Washington, about, you know, which is the focus of what I say here, I look at eight countries in pairs. I look at Japan, I look at Korea, I look at the PRC, China, and I look at Taiwan. I look at Singapore, and I look at Indonesia. I look at India, and I look at Burma. And, you know, there's detail. There's quite a lot of detail on how each of them operates in Washington. And the focus, of course, is the ones that we hear a lot about, China, Korea, and Japan in Washington. But I think there are a lot of things that you learn by comparing them with each other that we don't look at when we look just at them individually. The book has been translated into Japanese. Chuo Koron has just put it out in Japanese as Aja no Naka no Washington. And so it, you know, I think it's beginning to start, to me at least, an interesting debate about Japanese public diplomacy, about the rising competition in Washington between Japan and many other Asian nations. One aspect of this is different interpretations of history. Part of it is territory. And those, of course, have been in this 70th year of, after the war, of course, are very high profile. But I also stress there's a lot of other important areas where there's an implicit competition of ideas that involves this idea industry that we're writing about in Abenomics, for example. The interpretation of its potential for success, of what it actually means, of whether the third arrow is succeeding or not, about exchange rates. So there's a competition in Washington which has deepened, I argue. In the last two or three years, I would say it has deepened substantially. And different countries have different approaches, and it's interesting to take a look at how effective the different countries are. And I hope that I look forward to Professor Soeya's remarks, who has done very distinguished work on middle power diplomacy and so on, as many of you know. So I look forward to that, and that's very much related. But in the interest of time, let me just go through a few slides that hopefully will show you visually what it is that I'm arguing in the book, which Brookings Institution Press just published in the United States. First of all, as I say, we're entering into a world of global political cities. And on the heavily political side of the where their major stock in trade is political influence, we have Washington, D.C. On the other side of this typology, where their major stock in trade is economics, of course, we have New York City. Those are sort of two poles within the United States. And different places fall in different areas. Tokyo, I would say, is much more of a economically oriented city where its international influence is on the economic side. But cities are becoming more important. And in some ways, they are actually becoming more important than governments. Cities are changing in their general orientation on in terms of the degree to which government is central or the penumbra of power. Multinational corporations or NGOs or other groups are central. In the evolution in Washington has been this way. Before World War II, it was a more less centralized city. The government rapidly grew in importance after World War II. But gradually in recent years, lots more NGOs, lots more multinational corporations. Washington, D.C. today is becoming more of a multinational city, as I think we know. I have some more figures that we'll show you and talk about Washington's transformation. Well, one aspect of this, of course, is the foreign population of Washington is growing. Today, it's nearly triple what it was in 1970. My figures, these are from the 2010 census. Actually, we've seen some acceleration recently here as well. The concept of the penumbra of power that Andrew just addressed is quite central, really, to what I want to say. This is the shadow, if you want to call this the government, it's the shadow around the government. The heart of that, of course, is an information industry, as I put it, which traditionally was oriented toward research and generation of ideas, which is becoming increasingly oriented toward advocacy and public relations. The center of advocacy, I would argue, in Washington has begun to shift from K Street and the traditional lobbying firms. They're part of it, but their relative role is becoming relatively less, and the role of think tanks and Massachusetts Avenue, where those places are concentrated, I argue in the book, is becoming more important. So in the penumbra of power, the classical elements were the lobbyists, Boggs and Blow, that sort of group, law firms. The new elements and, there's a new structural phenomenon. Consulting and public relations firms have begun to merge with one another into information and media and influence conglomerates. Stonebridge Albright, for example, and Hogan and Lovell, law firms and public relation firms coming into closer relationships. There's some very interesting structural changes in Washington, many of them influenced by the information revolution. And I go into those in some detail in the book. Mass media, of course, is a major element of this, and mass media is also changing and being integrated with other industries. The coming of the internet is having a major impact. Think tanks are one of the largest of the elements of the penumbra of power. It's not only these kind of information industry elements. Universities, I guess we would have to say, having spent time in, I was Japan chair at CSIS and spent time in the government, but I'm mainly an academic. And so universities are on are the fringes of this. Also, we shouldn't forget that the headquarters of some of the most important multilateral institutions are in Washington. The International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the Inter-American Development Bank, and now in the era of the you know, the financial crises and so on that we've had, and the possibilities that the U.S., you know, the Congress might not, might close the government, or the U.S. might default. Some of these issues, Washington is growing more important on a whole range of financial questions as well. We don't have the time to go into all of this, but it was interesting to me. There's a geographical dimension to the idea of industry of Washington as it's emerging. The one which is right in the center geographically, this is DuPont Circle for you, and you know the White House is down here, and this is Embassy Row. You know, in the book I talk about the different groups in some detail. But the interesting point, I think, for our purposes here, the way that think tanks, each of these has sort of a community of its own. This is the embassies more, and of course you've got the International Van Ness, and the International Embassy Community. There's some other areas, but the heart of embassies is here. The heart of the National Press Club and media is more down here. Think tanks sort of are overarching across all of these, and in many different ways, the think tanks knit together these various portions of Washington and its idea industry. Washington also is becoming something more than just the District of Columbia. As you can see, this really began in after World War II, when the rate of growth of Greater Washington, the Beltway and beyond, has been accelerating, whereas the population of the district itself has been quite stable. There is a discontinuity here. Anybody who just drives down Massachusetts Avenue will and watch all the building cranes in Northeast and so on will appreciate what's happening. The District of Columbia is expanding, and its population is beginning to rise. So this trend could be reversed. But the Beltway, for our purposes here, we really have to remember is a major part of both the ideas industry and the penumbra of power of Washington. Here's what it looks like geographically. This is Washington, the District of Columbia itself. But what has emerged is two very large complexes, the Baltimore-Washington Parkway. You've got the BWI Airport up here. You've got Fort Meade. You've got the U.S. Cyber Command, the National Security Agency. It's not all military and intelligence, the NASA Space Center, for example. And then out the other way, you've got the Dulles Corridor leading out to Lowndes County, Virginia, which is the richest county on a per capita basis in the United States, which I think is a testimony to the dynamism of this new complex, which is emerging. And, you know, a lot of this is the information industry. America Online was born out this way. You've got Gannett Publications, USA Today. They're out this side. You've got Booz Allen Hamilton, which of course is a conglomerate that does a range of information-related activities. So Washington is changing. It's more than the District of Columbia. It's a very dynamic entity. In the last decade, it has grown much more rapidly than the nation as a whole, and includes some of the three, actually, of the five wealthiest counties in the United States. Now, how do Asian nations approach Washington? How do they differ, and what do we make of that? Maybe before I get into it, there's a blur of statistics here. Let me summarize my broad findings. It's not how large you are. It's not how large the country is. It's not how many lobbyists you have, I think, which is decisive. It's a combination of flexibility, the ability to meet the very rapid changes of the information revolution, the ability to respond. the ability to stay flexible. And also there's an ethnic politics dimension. Those are some of the elements I look at. And the countries, I think I told you before, 8 countries, but I purposely tried to compare large countries and a neighboring small country to test, in particular through this whole research, the relative influence, the relative ability to get what they want in Washington of small countries as opposed to large. And the conventional wisdom of, you know, realist political theory and international relations and so on would tell us that it's the large ones who overwhelmingly get what they want. And my argument is sort of the reverse of that. Not perfectly. We have to qualify it. But to put it crudely, that's what I'm arguing. Now, there's also an ethnic politics dimension that's begun to be appreciated in the U.S. Just let me say a word about that. In 1965, when our Immigration Act was changed, Japanese Americans were the largest of the Asian American groups. There were twice as many Japanese Americans, that's this dotted line right here, as there were Chinese Americans, which is this line right here. And you can see what has happened since 1965. Particularly the slope began to rise rapidly in the 1980s with the increasing liberalization of visa requirements and the outflow of people from China. This here, the Korean American population has been rising more rapidly than the Japanese from a lower level, as you can see. The striking thing, of course, is the Chinese Americans and Indian Americans recently have been rising even more rapidly. And I go into the political activities of each of these groups in Washington. The Asian American populations have traditionally concentrated, of course, out in Hawaii. There's only one U.S. foreign-born senator who happens to be Meiji Hirono. Many of you know Senator Hirono was born in Fukushima in Japan. There's a very large Japanese American community, which has, of course, historically been very influential in Hawaii. And in certain ways, there's been Senator Hayakawa from California. There's a reasonably large population in various states on the West Coast, and some states in this area, in the Northeast of the United States as well, including Virginia, New Jersey, New York State. Asian American population has been growing, relatively speaking, more rapidly. This interested me a lot in the South than any other part of the country. There are now two Asian American governors, and both Nikki Haley of South Carolina and Bobby Jindal of Louisiana they're both Indian Americans, which is interesting, and I go into this in the book. Indian American ethnic politics has actually been quite dynamic. And the political linkages of Japan and India, of course, these things are not directly related really in any way, but the Indian American influence seems to be rising in American politics. Now, just very briefly, because I look forward to Professor Soeya's comments and hopefully to our discussion. How do we explain, first of all, who does well in Washington? I want to say a few words about that. It's a very difficult, of course, influence, as Professor Abelson and Professor Horvatz or Professor Soeya, of course, and all of us know, is a subjective matter. It's difficult to measure. It's also important, terribly important. And these are impressionistic. It's a work in progress in that sense. But there's some rather dramatic findings that I found in my work. Let me show you. Well, one that interested me a lot is addresses to joint meetings of Congress by Asian nations since 1970. Israel, of course, is not an Asian nation, But as one might well expect, there have been many Israeli leaders as a nation of fundamental importance to the United States, and of course many, and of great interest to many, most Americans. It has its leaders typically speak to joint meetings of Congress. Now, within Asia, this interested me a lot. The most leaders who have spoken to Congress of any country in Asia is Korean leaders. And actually, every Korean president except Nomu-hyun, since democratization, has spoken to a joint meeting of Congress, including, of course, President Park, but President Lee Myung-bak, and, you know, going back ever since democratization. So Korea, in this sense, is quite influential in Washington, and especially with the U.S. Congress. India, to a slightly lesser, India is very dynamic. In other respects, India has gotten many of the things that it wants in Washington. The conspicuous thing to me was, of course, during World War II, Madam Chiang Kai-shek spoke to a rather historic session of Congress, but my data set is just the recent case. Taiwan, of course, is not diplomatically recognized, so that's not surprising. China, not surprising, perhaps. In the given the delicate geopolitical relations of U.S. and China. But Japan, that in a sense I think is a bit paradoxical. And, that's an issue we could go back to. There's many factors at work. It isn't only that Japanese leaders have not wanted to speak at one point, or even that the White House didn't want them to. Of course, as we well know, President Bush, 43, and Prime Minister Koizumi were close friends, and Prime Minister Koizumi was a strong friend of the United States and U.S. alliance. But he never addressed a joint meeting of Congress, which is an issue to some extent I talk about in my book. Maybe I'll leave that for discussion, because it's an interesting issue. This I'll just glass over. I looked at various successes that each country of the ones that I deal with did have some significant successes. But maybe just to narrow this a little to the issue of free trade agreements. There's two free trade agreements between Asian nations and the United States. One is by Singapore, the first, 2002. And the other one is South Korea, the Chorus Free Trade Agreement in 2012. There are also a conspicuous range of other diplomatic and especially legislative successes that Korea has had. I don't have enough time to discuss, but another country which is very striking that I talk about at length is Singapore. Singapore, the FTA agreement is one example, but Singapore has gotten many, many of the things that it wanted, almost everything that it wants in Washington. It has no formal alliance with the United States, no formal basing, although there are about 500 U.S. forces in Singapore. I remember when I was in the embassy here, our taxi receipts for going back and forth between Otemachi and Toranomon were invoiced and paid out of Singapore. So it does have some significant roles in the in American foreign policy and relating to Washington. Now, what kind of an influence model? I could go back more into influence, but the broad, just to give you the outlines, the three classical variables that people have talked about, if you say Pat Choate in Agents of Influence, which is a rather crude but controversial but prominent examination of Asia and Washington, two decades ago, you know, how big you are. How many lobbyists you've got, or how big is your embassy, that sort of stuff, these variables. The two that I privilege in my analysis I don't say that these don't exist, but I think they've been exaggerated. And this dimension, I don't think, has been given enough attention. Informal elite networks, the say that the ambassadors have, you know, where did they go to school? Who do they talk to outside outside of their formal discussions? What kind of informal institutions to support one's diplomacy are there? Like, for example, the Korea Economic Institute, which I think has been quite effective. Or, say, the offices of a country's business federation. Keidanren once had one. They closed it in 2009, for example. So these two, and I'll, of course, Professor Soeya is a real specialist on public diplomacy. I'll be interested in what he has to say about that. The last point, I think influence and visibility, and Professor Abelson's a real specialist on this. This is something in our conference later that we'll want to talk about more. Well, in the realist parameters, of course, China and Japan and India are the big ones. Classic diplomacy, this is how big is their embassy? China's embassy is the largest embassy in Washington. This is the diplomatic list for the 2013, which is the latest data I had. 194, it must have crossed 200 diplomats now. Japan is about half as large as that. Singapore, interestingly, here has only 20 accredited diplomats, but they got the FTA. There isn't a U.S.-Japan bilateral FTA, but there's a U.S.-Singapore. But the embassy is 20 people. Now, lobbying. This is interesting to me. In 1960, France had the largest number of lobbyists in Washington. In recent years, Japan has really topped the list. The number of lobbyists has gone down sharply, as you can see. In recent years, Japan, Asia has loomed very, very large in the number of formal lobbyists. There's informal, there's all kinds of informal activities, I grant, but we're doing what we can in terms of statistics. Japan, number one. Korea, number two. Canada, interestingly. We have our two Canadian scholars here, number three. Taiwan, number four. China, number five. And then you can see India is in the top 10, too. So we have four out of the top five, and we have seven out of the top 10 are Asian nations. Asian nations have been very active in the formal lobbying side. This has, it peaked. It peaked. This is the time of Pat Choate. When Pat Choate was writing, of course, there were a lot of lobbyists swarming around Washington. It's changing. There's a new route of influence. K Street has moved to Massachusetts Avenue, but not in the same form. I did look at the Foreign Agent Registration Act figures, which are interesting. They don't tell the whole story. For example, the media, CCTV, the Chinese broadcasting, has about 100 journalists. NHK has about 17 or so. But that doesn't, you know, they're not registered lobbyists. And, of course, media are not directly speaking or formally speaking lobbyists. The role of different countries' media is certainly something that one might want to look at. So the figures, some of the best figures we can get are this way. The interesting thing to me here was Japan. This is Japan. This is to the end of 2012. And I think it certainly is true that Prime Minister Abe has stressed public relations. He, no doubt, or the Abe administration, it is said, I don't have the figures on that. It was after my book went to press, has increased Japan's spending in Washington, but the long-term trend was down. And of course, there's also a revolving door at the prime minister's office in the Kante. You know, a new prime minister every year has not helped Japan in Washington. Korea, in contrast to this, particularly after President Lee Myung-bak came to power, was rising quite rapidly and outstripping Japan. China, on the formal side of things, rising from a smaller base. But as I say, particularly in the case of China, it seems likely that there are many aspects that are not covered, many important ones. So, this is about networks. The ambassadors are connected. But the smaller countries often have some of the most interesting networks. Without going into detail, I can say that. What I would like to say in conclusion is that the penumbra of power, the communities, the lobbyists, the media, the think tanks, the universities, the groups around government, which are not part of government, are becoming increasingly important in Washington. And that is a trend that I think is being mirrored and will be mirrored in future years in many other countries of the world. There are some, such as France, where it seems to be evolving rather slowly. There are others, such as Belgium, the European Community, Brussels, also London, where it seems to be evolving very rapidly. And there are some interesting comparisons in the that could be drawn with these other cases. Different countries approach differently. Japan approaches somewhat differently than the others. And these are subjects that we will be pursuing in the rest of the afternoon, and that our project that the Center for Global Partnership has been good enough to support is going to be continuing for at least the next 2 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kent. Now I'd like to pass the mic to Professor Soeya, and we're looking forward to some incisive comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is it on? Yeah.
If you could take this out.
Hold on. Yeah. Okay. It's such a privilege for me to be invited, in fact, by Professor Kent Calder personally. So I'm not on the program, so you may have been wondering who is sitting there.
You're very much a part of the program as far as we're concerned. Actually, I'm sorry about that.
That's not my fault.
I'm sorry. I'm extremely happy, partly because when I was in Washington for 6 months last year, affiliated with the Wilson Center, there are a few occasions where I would meet Professor Calder, invited by his center's Christmas celebrations and so forth. But I have never got to meet him while I was there. And I'm happy to be sitting just right next to him after some while. Because his book is such a, of course, gigantic intellectual product. And my comment is for purposes of just serving discussions and questions, I try to pose a question, maybe a somewhat the macro question, and with which I'm of course personally struggling still. I don't have any answer to that. And in doing so, please allow me to indulge in a little bit of my self-promotion of my work as well, following Professor Calder. It's not a book, it's an article to be published by a edited volume, edited by Jan Mellison, a Dutch scholar who is a specialist in public diplomacy. And the book is titled Understanding Public Diplomacy in East Asia. It's still a tentative title, but... So it's a comparison of public diplomacies among East Asian countries. Mm-hmm. And I contributed a chapter on Japan. And in that, I just traced the post-war evolution of Japanese public diplomacy. I will just briefly outline. Initial purpose of Japan's public diplomacy, there was no such concept at that time. But if we look back on those days, perhaps it's pertinent to call those behaviors as a kind of public diplomacy. Initial purpose was to recover from, naturally, the past image of Japanese militarism. And so naturally, there was a tendency to emphasize culture as an important tool to impress Japan otherwise, and which developed into the emphasis on intellectual exchanges between Japanese and external in Japan specialists. But the initial phase of intellectual exchange, I think, assumed that there were misunderstandings about Japan. So to correct misunderstanding was sometimes explicit, but mostly implicit purpose behind Japan's attempts to get into intellectual exchange. But then came somewhat later, emphasis on Japan's soft power, and the concept cool Japan was created by some Westerner. And when this cool Japan concept became very important, associated with Japan's so-called soft power, intellectual exchange went into, I think, a new dimension, which is to seriously seek so-called mutual understandings. It's not a one-sided attempt to so-called correct external misperceptions, but attempts to understand mutually. So foreign countries should understand Japan, of course, but Japan should also understand external countries. And I think that was so the evolution itself, I think, was rather positive. If you look back on the past Japanese attempts to engage in so-called public diplomacy. But more recently, this is related to the puzzle, which I'd like to address soon. In recent years, there is a new phenomenon of public diplomacy, which could be called so-called competitive public diplomacy. You are competing with, particularly East Asian context is important here. Japan is competing with South Korea. South Korean public diplomacy has a central aim of sort of competing with Japan. And so public diplomacy among East Asian countries started to assume this new sort of character of competition through public diplomacy. I think this is a new phenomenon. And I think this is going to be a transitional phenomenon, but how, I'm not sure. But here, the puzzle or the question that I like to pose is, up to the more recent years where this competitive public diplomacy became somewhat prominent, agents of public diplomacy were largely civil society actors, and including scholars. And so, but more recently, as a result of this competitive public diplomacy, mostly initiated by the government, becoming prominent, there was a tendency to press. It's not really explicit pressure, but scholars are now beginning to feel that the government would be more interested in so-called old Japan approach, from government to civil society. And it should be all Japan approach regarding Japan's important issues in the context of competitive public diplomacy. But civil society approach, of course, rested on the recognition of the importance of diversity. So you know, impressing foreign countries' audience with the fact, the reality that Japan is diverse, democracy, pluralism. I mean, this itself should have had a value. So here the question, puzzle is old Japan versus civil society diversity. I think that is increasingly becoming a problem in Japan's approach to public diplomacy. And in my personal experiences as a scholar in universities, and also my brief stay in Washington, D.C., I'd like to mention two things. As to the college education, from time to time, I talk to a group of students from Japan, Korea, China, which is a boom in the educational field to promote exchanges among these three Northeast Asian countries, CGK student exchanges. And I make it a rule when I give a talk to them to begin with something like follows. Don't talk about territorial issues. I know what you're going to say. And if you really believe those islands are yours from the bottom of your heart, this only proves that you are parochial nationalist, nothing more, nothing less. Because you just know what your government says, and you don't know what other people have in their minds when they talk about their positions. So don't talk about it. And this works. This works. But I know each government doesn't like it. And any government doesn't like it. So here, again, all Japan versus, you know, diversity among, you know, increasingly diverse young people. And in Washington, D.C., I think as a result of competitive public diplomacy getting grounds, I think issues which are being discussed in a competitive way are exactly issues which Japanese public diplomacy has traditionally avoided to address. And this is very typical in the activities of Japan Foundation, for instance, created in the 1970s. Their major projects are cultural exchange and intellectual exchanges. And the tendency is to avoid controversial issues. And the controversiality here is not between Japan and foreign countries. Controversiality is in the Japanese society. That's the reason why they would like to avoid. These issues are controversial even among the Japanese. So Japan Foundation is not in a position to sell any aspect of these complex, you know, dimensions of Japanese. And but in this competitive public diplomacy, those controversial issues are in fact the issues where governments are trying to impress international audiences in Washington, D.C., not only U.S. government, of course, toward more Japanese official position. So as a scholar, I had several occasions to talk to Washington audiences, but of course, I don't do that. I try to put that attempt in a much broader context as a scholar. But here, there is a question, you know, whether as a Japanese, I should be part of all Japan. Sometimes I do that, because I tell students, I know better than you, so maybe sometimes I will talk about these territory issues. But of course, that's from a Japanese position. Sometimes I do that, sometimes I don't. So here again, this question of, you know, all Japan versus diversity, civil society diversity, that this big question is always there these days. So those are my brief comments. I hope they will be helpful in a way. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Soeya. And the fact that you're not on the program is entirely my fault. I'm sorry.
No, I didn't
this has been a very wide-ranging professional lunch, as I'm sure you're aware. So I hope that the questions are also very wide-ranging. And I'm now going to open the floor to questions and working press first. But if there is no one from the working press, then someone with pressing work is fine too. Thank you. Yes, do I see a hand?
Right there.
Okay, sure. There you are. Thank you. Ah, yes. Please.
Yes.
Yes, of course. That's right. Yes, Anthony. Yes, sorry. The light is in my eyes.
Anthony Rowley, Singapore Business Times. Question addressed mainly to Professor Calder. Do you think the growth of this penumbra structure, as you call it, is a sort of natural part of the evolution of the democratic process? Or is it an insidious process whereby special interest groups can exert far more authority on government through narrow channels, and therefore the public interest will not be well represented?
That's an extremely interesting and important question, and that's one I might add that our three speakers in our conference today are also going to be addressing. Maybe as a first cut on that, I guess I would say that it's indeterminate. If in fact what one gets is a diversity of ideas and views, you know, that's the classical John Stuart Mill sort of competition of ideas, which of course is the essence of, I think, of what most of us think of the democratic tradition. Unfortunately, the emergence of the penumbra of power tends to privilege those with the resources to make themselves known particularly easily. There are technological changes, and I'll just briefly, Professor Abelson will, after 2 o'clock, will in detail begin to talk about this. But technological changes, such as podcasting, such as streaming video, such as in-house broadcasting studios, wiring, teleconferencing, the coming of the internet, all kinds of changes, of technological changes, particularly recently, have begun to create important barriers to entry and also advantages to those who have who have large scale and who have large budgets. The expansion of the theater, the stage of discussion from the local to the global does create a dynamic where those who have large resources and large policy networks have particular advantages. So there's a concentration, and there are important asymmetries. So broadly, I think the dynamic probably reinforces the free trade system or the open trading system, which I personally think that's an important positive. But that said, in terms of it privileges the large institutions, probably particularly the large think tanks, and they are looming larger and larger in the Washington idea industry, and Professor Abelson will talk more about that.
Thank you, Professor Kent Calder. My name is Konno, former government official. Thank you very much indeed. Very interesting observation you shared with us. One thing which struck me was that very visible high level of activity of Koreans in Washington. It seems that is one major message you're trying to convey to us. Mm-hmm. My question is, what is their objective? What kind of messages they want to convey to Washington policymakers? Is it just in competition vis-a-vis the Japanese, or do they have broader national strategic objective? Or if yes, what are they? Thanks. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I know that Professor Soeya also is a specialist on Korea, and so I hope he may chime in a little on this as well. I guess I would say that one should differentiate between national objectives, the things that are driven from Seoul, and the things that are driven from the various local communities, civil society communities in the United States. And there's some degree of difference. I mean, generally, they reinforce one another. But I think on some of the historical issues and so on, the local communities often are out ahead and more insistent than Seoul. Although it's hard to know what the interrelationship there is. One that Korea pushed through very strongly for, of course, was the KORUS agreement, the free trade agreement, which took, it's the largest free trade agreement that the United States has with any country. And it took, 5 years or so to negotiate, and then it took 3 or 4 years additional, 5 years or so, to ratify. So it was not an easy process. That's one major focus. Treatment as a priority allied nation for the purposes of defense procurement you know, getting particular high-level technology, high-performance equipment, that sort of thing. I think that has been one objective. The visa-free entry into the United States, or the visa waiver, is another development that, you know, Korea was interested in, that they succeeded in, so that there would be a freer flow of, you know, Koreans across the Pacific. Obviously, the history and the territorial issues, I think, are there. The exchange rates and so on are, they have influenced Korea. I don't know that those have been so explicit. Where you can clearly see both an objective and also a result are things like the visa waiver, like some of the defense procurement successes, and the KORUS free trade agreement. I don't know what Professor Soeya might add.
Would you like to comment?
Yeah, of course, it has multi dimensions, but from a Japanese perspective, perhaps the question maybe implied the importance of some of sometimes emotional and sometimes kind of physical, in the sense of territory, I mean, issues. And if that assumption behind the question is correct, let me make a few comments, which are as follows. As I observe Korean arguments, another PR. I'm now writing a book from my interviews of Korean public intellectuals. I interviewed about 20 Korean public intellectuals about their views about China, U.S., Japan, Korea, and so forth. And it will come out sometime around May from KEIO University Press. It's in Japanese, I'm sorry, but it's a compilation of interviews restructured according to themes. And so my comments are from those experiences of mine. I'm not a Korean specialist. My Korean is not terribly good, and so don't take me for that. But I'm very interested in Korea because I believe this is relations with Korea is perhaps the most important external relation Japan has in coming years. Just assume something happens in Korea, something, you know, what we don't want to see. All of a sudden, Korea would reemerge as the most critical security and other challenge to Japan, just like it was the case after Meiji Restoration. And but anyway, that's my motivation. I mean, behind my increased interest in Korea. And as to these sensitive issues, I think Korea has two basic fundamental things. One is this is an issue of justice and righteousness. And so it has nothing to do with relations with Japan. And so in that context, their goal is to appeal the Korean righteous position to the international community as wide as possible. And conceptually, emotionally, of course, human beings are all emotional, but conceptually, this has nothing to do with Japan necessarily. Japan just doesn't happen to be the target. And but of course, Japan factor is there. There are reactions regarding these issues simply because this is a Japan issue. And for the Japanese, of course, we tend to be preoccupied with this Japan aspect alone. But in the minds of Koreans, perhaps the fact that this is, according to them, is a question of justice. And I think that is very big, and that's a huge motivation for them. That's my impression. And so how these issues become big issues? I mean, initially, these are small movements by Korean NGOs and so forth. And at that level, it doesn't make any news or it doesn't become any political question. But when it becomes, the news in the New York Times or Washington Post, then American politicians have to respond. Almost always, American politicians' response to these questions, I think, happens after this originally tiny local issue has become very much national because of reporting. That's why reporters are important very much. And what triggers that development? In most cases, when Japanese government comes in and says something controversial in the ears of reporters, if not objectively, so to speak. Almost always, when the government officials or ambassador or something comes in and meet the governor and says something according to the line of the current conservative government, and American media likes to catch those things. And then this becomes national, creates a context in which American politicians, including local politicians, would feel compelled to respond according to local logics and national logics and so forth. So clearly, here's a vicious cycle. And this vicious cycle perhaps works maybe in a favorable way for Koreans, perhaps, creates an environment in which Korean insistence on justice and so forth would begin to make more sense to many people, very unfortunately, as a Japanese. But so that overall structure, I think, needs to be much more objectively analyzed and understood by the Japanese in dealing with the Korean question. That's my personal observation.
Can I have some more questions, please? Anybody?
You got one right there.
A hand up, yes. The gentleman with the hand, yes. Thank you. Could you please identify yourself?
Yes. Anthony Millington, European Automobile Manufacturers Association. From a third region perspective, I think it's always seemed as if in their approach to the United States, the Japanese have always perhaps excessively relied on the influence which they would hope would be exercised in Washington by the American embassy here in Tokyo and Omono Taishi. And perhaps that worked very well during the Cold War period, but as when the Cold War ended, the international system perhaps became more multipolar, the Japanese may have been somewhat slow to respond to this change, structural change, to develop the sort of direct contacts in Washington that some of their counterparts may have, as you've demonstrated, may have been more successful in doing. Do you think this is a fair explanation of what has happened? Have the Japanese perhaps relied excessively on the Chinichiha or the Shinichiha in Washington without being prepared to go out into the trenches and do the hard lobbying?
That's a very interesting and provocative question. And of course, having worked with U.S. Embassy Tokyo for some years, that interests me a lot, having worked with Ambassador Mondale and Foley and Baker a bit. I think the issues I'm talking about are public. There's the offensive dimension or creating new policies, and then there's the question of succeeding in preserving a basically open trading system and so on. And I think those are analytically two different questions. I wouldn't call anyone really a culprit in all of this, but it's probably true that the structure of formal, of governmental interest articulation on the ground in Tokyo by the government, if there's one single factor that might explain the differences of the different nations, I think it might be that. They have different, and it's best, I think I could best answer your question by some comparison. Japan's approach, of course, the Japanese multinational companies are, I think, very sophisticated and have been generally relatively good at, protecting their interests. But the on the formal side of things, Japan has relied quite heavily on, a formal mechanism, on an embassy and formal diplomacy and so on. If you contrast that, for example, to the Korea, the Koreans have a Korea Economic Institute, which is sort of semi-governmental. The KIEP, KIEP, operates internationally, doesn't operate directly in D.C., but there's that. There's the FKI, the Federation of Korean Industry. A multiplicity of organizations that are either informal or semi-governmental. Most of the it's interesting to note that Seoul's sister city in the United States is Washington. Beijing's sister city in the United States is Washington. Japan's sister city in the United States is New York. Japan has been, its private sector has been much more oriented to and operating out of New York City. And then the semi-government, many of the sort of, what should I say, listening posts or semi-governmental organizations that, that say the Koreans, just as one comparison, have continued to have and even increased in their scale in Washington, in Japan's case have been withdrawn. For example, Keidanren. Keidanren had an office in Washington until 2009, and they pulled it out. Japan Foundation once had an office in Washington, and it moved to New York City. Many of the large think tanks, Nomura Research, once had an office in Washington that it closed. There's been a trend after the trade war, so-called, quote, trade war issues ended or waned, for Japanese groups, I think, to feel that a Washington presence wasn't important. And then Japan didn't develop these kind of sovereign, especially they pulled out the semi-governmental or the non-governmental side. And especially in an era when the issue cycle is so rapid, the informal side, I think, of agenda setting in Washington is becoming more important. And probably in that area, Japan, compared to some of the others, has moved less rapidly. That's sort of what how I would explain it.
I'd like to use the chair's prerogative to ask a question from Professor Soeya, who wrote a book on middle power diplomacy. And I think that you argue that Japan should act more like a middle power. Do you think that, given what Professor Calder has said today, that Japan took your advice to heart and is acting more like a middle power, or is perhaps Korea doing better acting as a middle power? Or is this a leading question?
I don't know whether you have noticed or not, but I've never used the term middle power in my talk. But not because I changed, but increasingly, I think we are moving in that direction. But the thing is, it's not an argument Japan should behave like a middle power. My argument is Japan's actual behaviors in much of the post-war years have resembled those of middle power, for the lack of a better term. Clearly, Japan has never played the role of so-called traditional great power. In the domain of politics and security. Economically, yes, of course. So this is an argument in political and security dimension, and which is very important because often the time, Japan's defense policies and the defense budgets, I mean, those issues tend to be interpreted totally in an inappropriate context. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's far out of touch of the realities, in many discussions about, for instance, Japan going nuclear, or Japan engaging in military competition with China. Those are really silly if you look at, real substance. None of those elements, in our behaviors. And so if you actually look at Japanese actual behaviors, so my counter question to those who challenge my argument is, then just give me just a single case where Japan behaved like a typical independent security actor in the side of US, China, Russia in the post-war years. I think zero, naturally. So where we have spent money, human resources, financial resources, and so forth, it's much closer to typical middle power diplomacy. Emphasis on regional development, regional integration, economic development of developing countries, contribution to international institutions, and commitment to globalism, and so forth. No element of unilateralism, which is a characteristic of great power to me. And but again, as I said, there are perceptions, totally different perceptions. So filling that gap is sort of my sense of academic mission in my work. You have to fill that gap. Otherwise, not only Japan is accepted in its kind of, you know, real kind of profile, but our domestic discussions, you know, our domestic policy making, domestic discourses also will continue to remain very much divided and very much complicated. And that's my sense and I mean assumption behind this argument. But as I said, I mean, coming years, so to Koreans, I'm saying this, middle power argument for Koreans is an aspiring concept. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's an aspiration when they talk about middle power diplomacy. But if we make this argument, or I make this argument, it's taken as a kind of, you know, declining sort of, thing. But if that's okay, that's okay. I'm telling Korean. That means we are getting close. You know, we're getting to, you know, closer. Mm-hmm. And which creates the situations where we have to think of regional issues, future vision of East Asia, our policies toward China, and not only China, but the U.S., in the common language and in the common concept. You know, and so the more we cooperate, I think we will be able to create some sort of infrastructure in East Asia, regional infrastructure, mm-hmm. out of cooperation of these East Asian countries. Mm-hmm. And Australia is of course important. ASEAN is also very important. Yeah. And in the last chapter of my book, which published in 2005, Japan's Middle Power Diplomacy, my conclusion was middle power networking among Japan, Korea, Australia, ASEAN. And of course, natural starting point is typical non-traditional security cooperation. Mm-hmm. And we do have foundation. Japan and Australia had security declaration, which is a typical middle power security cooperation, if you look at the substance. And we have AXA, acquisition and, you know, cross-servicing agreement between the two militaries. And Japan and Korea came very close to actually signing and concluding AXA at the end of the Imeobak government. So trilateralizing AXA among Japan, Australia, Korea is not impossible, mm-hmm. you know, if there is a will. The foundations are there. But mm-hmm. politically and otherwise, nobody's in that mood mm-hmm. right now. And that's really huge, huge opportunity cost, so to speak, mm-hmm. you know, between Japan and South Korea. Mm-hmm. So I don't think it's going to happen during my lifetime, but that's the kind of thing that I'm pushing in mm-hmm. talking about this concept with Koreans. And mm-hmm. to me, this should be a strategic focus of Japanese diplomacy. But mm-hmm. As I said, it's more creates more confusion rather than clarity mm-hmm. among ourselves too.
Mm-hmm. Well, Professor Soeya, I hope you live a very long life. Uh-huh. Kent, I think you have some comments.
Yes. Yeah, I was just going to say, I think that could be very, very fruitful and important in the bilateral relation of Korea and Japan. I'm not sure that meets the demands of what's an inevitable a competition probably in Washington, D.C. The low profile, you know, a conciliatory approach, and if what you mean is an institution building approach that's quite concrete, and you know, the Obama administration also, for example, wants to build a multilateral structure. And if Japan has concrete proposals and they're well publicized, I think that would certainly contribute to Japan's standing in Washington. And certainly people like Ambassador Sasai, after all, he was a participant in the six-party talks, a key person. I think he has made important contributions. But the problem, and I go back to, I think you admitted this too, there is a competitive element of Japan's presence in Washington that's probably inevitable. I agree with you totally on the issues of history and territory. I think a low profile, understanding others, is the best way to proceed. That said, it's not going to stop the other countries from being very, very proactive. And if Japan at some level, in some subtle or some way, doesn't express itself and engage proactively, I'm not sure if its views will, you know, will be accepted more broadly. The world's a competitive one, I guess, is that's the final word that my sense.
Any other questions? At first, sorry, your name. Siegfried, sorry, and then Anthony later, okay? And then we'll have to wrap it up. Thank you.
Siegfried Nidl, freelancer from Germany. What kind of role that does English language speak in for Washington to getting this role, English as a lingua franca? And what and so then Japan and Asian countries have some difficulties with dealing with it, but in a different Japan, it seems, might have much more difficulties than other countries. What is it correlation to this? And the question to Professor Soeya, has not Japan difficulties to acknowledge really it's a middle power? Does not Japan's policy every time is a kind of a ambivalence between to want to be a great power and in reality see it's not a great power? It's not a clarity in a strategic thinking in Japan. Would it be necessary to have a clear strategy, what kind of role it will play in the future? So it means to play a role as a middle power, not as a great power.
Do you want to take that?
The last question is in a way easy, substantially very difficult, of course, but because nobody in the government is talking about middle power, so it's only me, so and, I'm fighting a lonely kind of battle, and that's my quick answer. And flip side would be then what's our strategy? I think it's a state of confusion even among academics. And one group, of course, tend to premise implications of Japanese arguments and policies on the basis of Japan maybe wanting to become a great power, which is a typical normal country argument. And I made an argument in my article, introduced in my bio. In fact, what Japan has been doing in terms of changing its diplomatic and security policies, is Japan's move more toward a sort of normal, full-fledged middle power, rather than saying goodbye to the post-war Yoshida framework, but rather even changing Article 9, to me, has an implication for Japan to become a full-fledged middle power, rather than becoming a militarily independent, great power. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we are debating that, strategic argument at all. Mm-hmm. But then what? If they don't like middle power concept, what? We don't have that debate.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just very briefly on that very interesting question about the role of English language as a factor in Washington. The first thing I guess I'd say, of course, is that the people we have been spoken. There's so many Japanese players in Washington who are so articulate. I think that's the first thing in English that you have to say. But that said, first, it's true enough that two at least of the countries that I found in Washington who are very active and very effective are the ones that have English as a lingua franca, sort of, that Singapore and India are both quite effective for different reasons. But then the most important point I would make that I think affirms in a way sort of your supposition is that many of the countries that are not English-speaking, such as China and Korea, have semi-governmental or non-governmental organizations whose representatives actually are Americans. They're headed by Americans. Take, for example, the Korea Economic Institute. It's a director, there's a former Manzullo, a former U.S. congressman who heads that. Formerly, that was Jack Pritchard, who was, worked on the National Security Council. In CCTV, Jim Lorry, right, who was one of the last journalists out of Saigon in 1975. He plays the key role as a front, sort of commentator and so on for CCTV, for the Chinese. And well over half of CCTV's office in Washington is Americans. So there's an American face, for better or worse, on the efforts, the public relations efforts of, I think, of both Korea and China, just to cite two examples. And that's much less prominent in the case of Japan.
Thank you. We have one last question, and I know, Anthony, you wanted to ask it.
We're talking about Washington as the center of the world here, of course, and in many ways it is, but I mean, that will not... This is not a personal thing, actually. But as the balance of power changes and as other countries like China and Japan and India become more important, how does the penumbra, how do the penumbra institutions adapt to that? Do they give up and go home, or do they try to find somewhere else, exercise their power in different capitals, or what? I mean, I'm just rather interested in your views.
Yeah, that's a very, very interesting question that suggests the idea industry ought to look at London, certainly, and Brussels and Beijing and, you know, or Tokyo and a number of other locations. I think even if it's the case, and it's probably fair to say, I mean, the last few years, the U.S. budgetary problems, and there's arguments both ways. And I once wrote a book called The East Asia Edge, 1982, that was talking about sort of the waning American role. And I was right in some things, but I'm not, you know, that one needed some revision. So the penumbra institutions, whatever happened, the analogy, I think, is the city of London, in a sense, but in the political world, that what we're getting is a set of institutions that are globally competitive, that are globally oriented, that are related, of course, and playing off of American global influence, but are beginning to transcend that. It just, you know, they're all, it's a classical Michael Porter, a competitive cluster. You have like Madison Avenue, like Silicon Valley, like Wall Street, like the City of London, of institutions that play off one another and that transcend the original or the, you know, the reason for their original existence. I think that is what you're getting in Washington. And, you know, some even of the issues that we've been discussing here, you know, you want to take the history, you want to take the comfort women. It didn't involve the United States at all, those issues originally, and yet Washington has become a place where those things are heavily debated. Or, you know, what should we say about Abenomics? It affects the U.S. in some ways, but it's a much more global question. What about a whole series of, you know, human rights questions? What about South African, you know, I mean, all kinds, you could name it. There's all kinds of global issues on which Washington that don't relate to American policy, where the United States, where the penumbra of power has become central. And I think just because of the dynamics that it has there, just as in the case of the City of London, you know, whose role has persisted over time, I predict that it will continue to be important, although we will get Brussels, London, Tokyo rising as well. That's the subject of our idea industry conference, though, that is coming up now.
So thank you very much. And please, if you have the time and the inclination, do stay for the session that begins at 2 o'clock. That's not a professional luncheon, but it is free. Thank you for your patience. And thank you also to Kent and also to Professor Soeya. And now, if any of you wish to open a lobby office or a think tank and call it Penumbra, you have to pay royalties to Kent. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.